All right, so here we go. A little bit about lab number 10. Second to the last lab, woohoo! Only one more after this. And this lab then is all about galaxy classification. And hopefully you've talked a little bit about this in lecture, but there's this idea that, you know, for a long time we've known that there are things up there in the night sky that aren't necessarily stars. And it's sort of a generic term, might be nebula, which just means fuzzy. So there are these fuzzy little blobs out there, clearly not stars like what's in this picture. And sort of, you know, what's up with those things? And for a long time, you know, people have been looking and they've seen, you know, some of these nebula, some of these fuzzballs sort of have sort of a spiral shape like this. Some of the other fuzzballs are just sort of indistinct fuzzy things, sort of circular or elliptical, something like that, but they don't really have any sort of discernible structure associated with them. And it's always been a question, though, when you go out and you see something like this and something like this, and you see these little fuzzballs out there that are clearly not stars, you sort of got two choices. Are these small things that are up close, like maybe this is a nearby forming star right here, or are they very, very large things that are incredibly far away? Sort of the idea then, you know, people talked about this idea of island universes or you know, a precursor of our notion of galaxies. And this was a huge debate in astronomy. Just what are these things? And in order to really answer that, well, you need to figure out the distances to them, which it turned out to be really hard. And it wasn't really until sort of the early 1900s. This is a picture then that was taken the night of October 5th through 6th then in 1923 by an astronomer known as Edwin Hubble on the 100-inch telescope at Mount Wilson at the time. It was the largest telescope in the world, and this is a photographic plate, so it's a piece of glass with a photographic emulsion on it. You know, back in the old days when we used film, these were the chemicals then that would get dark if you exposed them to light, and so it's essentially a negative here on this picture. What's bright is stuff where no light struck the plate, and where it's dark then is where a lot of light struck the plate, and you can see stars and stuff, and you can also see then this big fuzzball here. There we go. This big fuzzball here, which is of course the Great Spiral Galaxy. Oh, sorry, no, Spiral Nebula. I've given it away, but you already know that. The Great Spiral Nebula then, in Andromeda. And what Hubble was doing is he was trying to look for novae then in M31 then. And again, you remember nova then? They're not supernova. Novae then. They're white dwarfs going around stars, and its companion starts to evolve. The normal star that the white dwarfs going around starts to evolve. Matter from that evolving star then ends up falling onto the white dwarf. You build up a thin little layer of hydrogen that gets hotter and hotter and hotter, hits 10 million Kelvin, then boom, or actually 5 million Kelvin, and the hydrogen's going to flash. And they noticed then what looked like nova, just in terms of the pattern of brightening and decreasing then in the spiral nebula that was Andromeda. And they noticed then that they looked a lot like galactic nebula, nearby nebula, but they were much, 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 much fainter. And so the idea was maybe they could use these as standard candles or some way of figuring out then the distance to this thing. And you can see, you know, Hubble's looking for the novae. And so every few nights then he goes out and he takes another image. It's like a 40-minute exposure. And you can see he found a little nova here and he's marked them. You know, there's a little tiny nova right here and there's a little nova right here. And you can see though, after a couple weeks of observing, he realized this actually wasn't a nova that was changing brightness. This is actually a variable star. And at that point, boom, you're good to go, because you've got this idea of variable stars, in this case, and Cepheid variable stars. And, you know, he found them in Andromeda. This is a few exposures then of different dates, December 17th, 21st, 30th, and January 26th, of a Cepheid variable then in Andromeda. And you can actually see it changing brightness over time. And there it is right there. And it's real obvious in this picture, but of course, Hubble didn't have space telescope yet. But anyways, you'd see what's going on here. And the minute you find one of these Cepheid variables, you know there's a relationship then between how fast it pulsates, its period, its luminosity. You can compare then the luminosity with how bright it appears in the sky, and boom, you can get the distance. And then Hubble, by finding one of these stars, one of these Cepheid variables in the Great Spiral Nebula of Andromeda, he was able to prove then that it was about 1.5 million light years away. And the actual distance is about 2.54 million light years away. And that's just because Hubble didn't know. It turns out, and we've sort of not talked much about this, but there are actually two types of Cepheids. But at any rate, he realized it was millions of light years away. There's no way this thing can be in our galaxy. He also estimated the size of it. Is it approximately the size of our own Milky Way, you know, 100,000 light years across, and all of a sudden this idea, here's another galaxy just like the Milky Way. This idea then of these are actually island universes or other galaxies of stars, of hundreds of billions of stars out there in space. And since then, we've been able to find a lot more of them then. We estimate that observably, if you go out and look, you can probably find about 200 billion observable galaxies, each of those with, 100 or so billion stars in them. And at that point, the numbers just get so big. It's so crazy. But 200 billion observable galaxies. This one is one of the recent record holders then at a distance of about 13.3 billion light years away then. And it's really just, less than half a billion years after the Big Bang and the initial formation of the universe. And we'll talk, well, hopefully in lecture, you'll talk a little bit about how that's a really short time scale to start assembling things in a universe, and that gets into dark matter. So anyways, that's stuff for lecture. In any case, then, this is a pretty typical example then of one of these early galaxies, and maybe only about 2,500 light years across. It's about 1/100th the mass of the Milky Way then. So just a little baby galaxy then, just shortly after the formation of the universe. Anyways, okay, so what we're after in today's lab is this idea of going out though and seeing these galaxies, and the idea then that the galaxies come in sort of different shapes or sort of different properties, different appearances. And of course, the first thing you're going to want to do in that case is come up with a way of classifying, and that way you can talk about the differences then between these galaxies in terms of some classification system. And this is Hubble's classification system from 1926 then, where you've got elliptical, spirals, and barred spirals. And we'll start off then with spirals. These are like what you think of probably when you think of a galaxy. This is a spiral as seen from above, and you notice then there's sort of a nuclear bulge here, and then you've got these beautiful spiral arms that are being lit up then by these blue stars, and you go, oh, they're blue stars, and there's current star formation going on. And this sort of makes sense because you see all this dust in this area too, and realizing then that the stars are born from gas and dust. So yes, these are new stars then, basically lighting up the spiral arms then in this spiral galaxy. And looking at it from the side, what you're seeing with the spiral arm is basically a disk of dust, gas, and new stars. It's also filled with old stars too. And you just don't notice the old stars because all the high mass stars are gone in an old population of stars. And you're just left, if these are sort of population two stars from, very early on in the galaxy's life, you're talking about K stars, M stars and K stars, and that's it. And so they're not emitting a lot of light. It's the blue stars then in the disk that are really lighting it up. And those are the massive stars. Those are the young stars. Anyways, looking at a spiral then, you'll see sort of a bulge or a nucleus here. You'll see a lovely flattened disk then with star formation, dust, maybe even some H2 regions, things like that. And much, 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 much harder to see then will also be a halo then surrounding the spiral. And so, looking at something like this, you can really see what I'm talking about with the age differences between the populations here. You've got this lovely star formation, recent stars, massive stars, as well as low mass stars, lighting up the arms. But you get towards the bulge here then, and it's more sort of a yellowish light, and that's just because there are no blue stars around here then. This part of the galaxy hasn't formed, this nuclear area hasn't formed any stars recently. And hopefully in lecture you talked about these spiral arms, really sort of density waves, sort of like traffic jams in the arms of the spiral galaxies. All right, what we're after here though is looking at spirals and noticing they sort of come with sort of different morphologies then. you can talk about then spiral galaxies with very, very tightly wound arms and large nuclear bulges relative to the size of the galaxy. Hubble talked about these then as S for spiral, and then A types, SA type galaxies then with larger bulges then and tightly wound arms. And at the extreme other end then, or what Hubble talked about is S for spiral, capital S for spiral, and then C. So these are spiral galaxies with relatively small nuclei and loosely wound arms. And sort of in between then, these are the B-type spirals, the SBs with relatively, halfway in between in terms of the size of the nucleus, and halfway in between then just in terms of how the arms are wound. And so that's a typical spiral then, looking at the size of the nucleus, how tightly the arms around them. That's how you can decide then what type of a spiral you're looking at. But of course, 65%-ish of the spirals out there don't have the round nuclear bulges. They have elongated or stretched out nuclear bulges or nuclei then. And these are referred to then as barred spirals. And Hubble gave them a type S for spiral, but then he put a capital B after it then to let you know that the nucleus then was sort of bar-shaped like this. And we think the Milky Way is probably a barred spiral, and this might be a view of the Milky Way from above. And here's our nuclear bulge, and it's definitely elongated, something like that. You've got some nice spiral arms then coming off of it, a few little spurs then, or partial spiral arms, that you can see. And here's the sun then right here in the Orion Spur, about two-thirds of the way from the center then, off in the cheap seats of our galaxy. But barred spirals then are classified just like regular spirals, where there's an S and then there's a capital B for barred, but then there's an A, B, or C. And for the type A barred spirals then, the nucleus fairly big and prominent, the spiral arms very, very tightly wound, and at the other extreme then, a relatively small nucleus then, compared to the size of the disk, and much looser arms. So we've got that then in the case of the spirals. There are other galaxies out there then that don't show the spiral structure, that more look sort of more like balls of stars. And these are referred to then as elliptical galaxies. And when you look at an elliptical galaxy, then you don't see any sort of a disk-like structure. There's no new star formation going on. And that's because there's very, very little dust and gas in these ellipticals. And so it's really just a collection of old stars, because without any dust and gas, you can't form any new ones. And the massive ones then have all died. And so you've got then a low mass group population of stars. Those are all cooler stars, and you get a much more yellowish light from these. And it's really just like a swarm of bees then, all orbiting around the center of the galaxy, as opposed to having a nice organized disk-like structure like this. This is all like, woo, everybody's on their own orbit around the center. This is M87 then, Messier 87. And this one's particularly cool because it actually has a jet of stuff then being squirted out the center, and we think because there's a supermassive black hole at the center then, this is material then that's been ejected perpendicular to the accretion disk of that black hole in the center. But you'll learn more about that in lecture. Ellipticals then, to designate an elliptical, it's a capital E for elliptical instead of an S for spiral, and then there's a number after it then. And mathematically, that number is 10 times 1 minus the ratio of the long axis to the small axis. Not going to get into any of that. It's just a measure then of how flattened the galaxy is. And if it's a round galaxy, we talk about it as E0. If it's a little bit of flattening, E2, more flattening, E3, more flattening, E4, and E5. And the flatter it is then, the bigger the number it is. And I always remember it then by zeros kind of round. And so, yeah, if it's an E0, it's a round elliptical, and then they get sort of flatter and flatter and flatter. The most elliptical galaxy you'll ever see, the most stretched out, I should say, elliptical galaxy would be an E7. And there's nothing more than an E7 in tonight's lab. So ellipticals then, fairly straightforward. There is one curious sort of galaxy that's sort of halfway between Ellipticals and spirals, these are referred to as lenticular galaxies or SO-type galaxies. And these are sort of weird because they show a bulge and sort of a disc-like structure. Here's an SO from the side, here's an SO from above, and you can sort of, it sort of looks sort of like a disc, but you don't see any dust, gas, or star formation in these things. So it's almost like a spiral galaxy that someone's just come along and they've pulled all of the dust and gas out of this spiral galaxy. So you still have the spiral structure and the nuclear bulge and maybe even the halo, but all the star formation's done because you removed all of that dust and gas. So they're very, very curious objects. You also have other, I should also say, you will not see one in the lab tonight, just because they're a little confusing to classify. There will be no S0 types in the lab tonight. That won't even be a choice for your classifications. Other galaxies, though, are even weirder. So this is Centaurus A. This is a giant elliptical galaxy, but it's got this huge dust lane across, which is super weird for ellipticals because they don't have dust and gas in them. And the idea behind this, though, is maybe that dust and gas is left over from the collision of this elliptical galaxy with a spiral galaxy, where you'd have the elliptical and the spiral comes in, and that's going to bring dust and gas with it in the collision. And this whole idea, though, of going out and seeing then maybe galaxies in the process of collision or having been through a collision, and you, oh man, yikes. But it turns out that's not uncommon at all. It can greatly change the structure and appearance and the future of a galaxy, but it's not weird at all, or it's not uncommon. This is the Milky Way here, and holy moly, if you look way over on the other side of the Milky Way then. So here we are on Earth, we're looking towards the plane of the Milky Way. This is the sort of nucleus, the bulge of our galaxy. So here we are, and here's the bulge. So here we are, here's the bulge. We're looking off over here, and yeah, we're actually colliding with a small dwarf galaxy, the Sagittarius dwarf, even as we speak. It turns out it's not really that big a deal if you think about the spacing between the stars relative to their sizes. In these collisions, the stars pretty much, they don't really hit each other. They're much too small relative to their separations. Collisions are extraordinarily rare, but you do get distortions then where the gravity of one galaxy then is going to mess with the orbits of stars in some other galaxy. And this really is our future. We're basically on a collision course with the Andromeda galaxy. And in about 4 billion years or so, right when our sun is thinking about dying then, we'll have a collision then going on then with Andromeda. And so there are these collisions and some galaxies then that we see out there that don't match any of the patterns, elliptical or spirals, and may well be the result of these collisions. And these galaxies then that don't really fit the two big types, spirals or ellipticals, then these are referred to then as irregular galaxies. And here we have like NGC 55. This is likely the result of a collision then. And in a lot of these irregular galaxies then, you do see dust and gas and just intense star formation. And if it's the result of a collision, you know, maybe that's just the result of all the compression of the clouds and that collision and the stuff, you know, the clouds hitting each other then, not the stars, but those big, you know, molecular clouds that are like a light year across and just hitting each other and triggering then star formation. And so here's another example of one. This is NGC 1427 then. And again, just tons of star formation in this irregular. And if you ever get a chance to go to the southern hemisphere and you look up on a nice dark night, you might see something like this, where here's the plane of the Milky Way then, and there are these two fuzzballs up here then that are the Large and the Small Magellanic Clouds. And they were there long before Magellan, and the indigenous people of the southern hemisphere, of course, knew about them. But it was Magellan that went and reported them to the Europeans, so that's why we call them the Magellanic Clouds. But these are actually satellite galaxies to our own Milky Way. They're very, very small, but they're also then these little tiny irregular galaxies that there are in orbit around the Milky Way. So there are these other galaxies and these irregulars that don't fit the two sort of patterns, spirals and ellipticals. Okay, so sort of to sum it up though, Hubble originally sort of came up with a sequence like this, where you start with the ellipticals and basically the E zeros, and you get, they're basically flatter and flatter up to, I should have done a better diagram here, then up to like sort of E7 or so. Then there are the lenticulars, the SOs, and then the spirals, which can be split up into spirals with sort of spherical, or I shouldn't say spherical, but spirals with normal bulges in, and spirals with elliptical or elongate, I'm going to say elongated barred spirals like this. And Hubble did sort of see it as an evolutionary sequence. And it's not. You can't go from a spiral to an elliptical. You can't go from an elliptical to a spiral. So yeah, that didn't work out so well, but it's still the way we talk about galaxies. So if you talk about, you know, the Milky Way, it's like an SBB or maybe an SBC, something like that, then it's definitely an SB type galaxy. Anyway, so your job tonight, if you go on the As You Learn page, then it's basically set up as a quiz. There are 20 galaxies that I'm going to ask you to classify then in terms of Hubble schemes. There will be no S0 galaxies on here, though. So it'll just be ellipticals, regular spirals, and barred spirals. And the way it's going to work then is for the ellipticals, remember then, the bigger the number, the more elongated it is. And if you're within one on your, you know, number, if it's really an E3 and you guess E2, you'll get full credit. If it's an E3 and you guess E4, you'll get full credit. And certainly if it's an E3 and you guess E3, you'll get full credit for that too. So for those then, if you're within plus or minus one on the number, that's fine, you'll get full credit. You'll also get two shots at these then. So if you guess like it's an SB and you go, oh, that's not right, you'll have another shot then. Maybe you want to guess SC or SA, depending on how tightly wound those arms are. Anyway, so for each of them then, you'll get two tries. And it should, it's been beta tested, this should work then. And at the end, it's just going to record basically how well you did with the classification. I should also let you know it's going to be randomized, so it's going to be hard to sit next to a friend and sort of go through this, because the galaxies they see are going to be different from the galaxies you're seeing. So, sorry. Anyways, that should be it. It should be pretty straightforward. Probably ain't going to take you more than about 20 minutes to go through these. And good luck. And of course, if you have any questions, let me know. And one lab to go. All right.